Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the concept of the Akhirah starts on the very position that one calls himself a believer. Faith is not by chance. Belief in Allah and the unseen is not by chance. The Akhirat and the life of the hereafter is something that is the greatest of value that no one can buy. We can only receive this from Allah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Let's make dua inshallah, Ustaz. Allahumma ameen. Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam tabarakta ya dal jalali wal ikram. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina wa shafi'ina wa habibina wa maulana Muhammad wa barak wa sallam. Allahumma rabbana zidna ilman nafi'ah wa amala mutakabbala wa rizqan wasa shifa'a min kulli da'ah. فسبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Continuing on amongst his companions of Ashar al-Mubashara, those who are given the glad tidings of paradise, and we were speaking about Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu and his position of adopting and coming into Islam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessing him to be amongst the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not only that alone, but being a very close relative to that of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being his cousin, being from the same clan, Quraysh, and also being from amongst the ones whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given a special position, not only granting him paradise, but also making him a close connection to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That it is mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just as Musa was onto Aaron as a brother, having that mantle of leadership and following as a successor to Musa. Similarly, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions that Ali radiallahu anhu has been given that mantle of leadership and following in successorship. The only difference being that there is not any other prophet to come after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But nonetheless, he had been given a level of high authority and closeness to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who will also be given that closeness not only in this life but in the life of the hereafter in Jannah, close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Such a companionship and such a relationship. Such a relationship was gained because of the fact that Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was in the position of with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam whilst the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made migration from Makkah to Medina. Where was Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu? On the bed of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, emulating his condition. Ali radiallahu ta'ala was that companion who made migration at night to Medina, and in such a condition his feet got blistered by walking towards Medina. Subhanallah. Among these are many other qualities, but when he adopted khilafat and leadership of the caliphate, that is when his challenge became even more difficult upon him. First of all, he never wanted to adopt this khilafat and based on the condition and the situation that surrounded it, because he had preferred it being in the condition as it was at the time of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when there was a group of people who would decide who should be the caliph. But the people at that time who demanded him to become the caliph and that surrounded him, they said that there is no one to take the position right now, and we have understood that. And he accepted it based on the principle that he was preventing further bloodshed and further amount of disunity in the Ummah and the fragmentation of the Ummah. So he decided to take up this and reunite the Muslims under the banner of Islam again. And this was his challenge. But the challenge that he also faced was not this only. We mentioned of a number of things. One, that he had to bring the people under one state again, of getting all the different nations on the different places where governors were established by Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu to come under one assessment of one leader and accepting his khilafat. Apart from that, he had the challenge of people getting the wanting the assassins of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala. And this proved to be what? An excuse, or what was being used as a challenge against Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, for him handing over these people whom he did not even know himself. But under this condition, he had to face up with amongst them people of his own, meaning Muslims against Muslim, in order to arrest the situation and to bring it under control, which had brought us to the point when he had reached towards Basra and he had to face up with Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha and her army. And we talk about the battle of the camel, the Jamal. And in that battle, we had saw in it mention of the companions who fought in it at the first time, and some of them who were killed, and it was a very sad day, and Ali radiallahu ta'ala himself was very what? Sad at such an occasion that such a statement will and such an action will take place amongst the Muslims. But nonetheless, he had gotten back control of it, and that the people saw in him that he was a true caliph and a person who really was there for the purpose of establishing the true khilafat and the true leadership of the Muslims. And at that point in time now, his final bid was for the challenge he had faced with Muawiyah, which we are going to discuss tonight in the conclusion of his khilafat and his leadership, and also what he stood for. So after facing that difficulty, Muawiyah now comes his final target and challenge. And after this, now he turns his attention towards Muawiyah again. Ali radiallahu ta'ala, who was now ruling over the whole Islamic state with the exception of Syria. And Syria till today, well, seems to be unruly still. He did not want a war, but to have a peaceful settlement as mentioned above. Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu demanded the handing over of the killers of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala. However, 10,000 of Ali radiallahu ta'ala men came towards Muawiyah's messenger, the one who sent to convey this message to Ali, and said that they are the assassins. In other words, they made it very difficult. He said, we are there, carry us, 10,000 of us if you want. From this, he said to the messenger that you can see now my situation. I am unable to find the assassin. It's very difficult for him to pinpoint this because he had tried at the very beginning of his khilafat. During all his difficulties now he is faced with this position to tell him and negotiate before any type of war would take place. Listen, I cannot tell you who exactly is the assassins of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, but at least, you know, carry back and convey this message. And this in itself proved that the only outcome was that he had to face up with Muawiyah. And then this led to the battle of Siffin, one of the biggest battles of the Muslims against Muslims. This battle was such a battle that it had 150,000 Muslims on Ali's army and in Muawiyah's army 130,000 plus Muslims facing each other. So this is not just any small army, but it's a huge army. At that time, amongst the Muslims, subhanAllah, they're not going out to expand the da'wah, to spread Islam further, but they are now facing a confrontation amongst themselves. So, looking at this condition, they said that Ali had 50,000 men to fight the Syrians. And when Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu heard of Ali's army, he came out with a large army, but he got the better position on the battlefield in Siffin. Ali radiallahu ta'ala now reached to Syria and he still wanted peace and tried to explain to Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala that he will avenge the death of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He's going to do that. Not that he's not going to do it. It is with his intention to do this, but it will take some time. But he pledged loyalty must be taken without condition. He says, listen, I'm going to do what I have to do to get the assassins of Uthman. But this must happen under one leadership. Not two different leadership. What you want is what I also want. You know, he's not saying that I want something different. What you want is also what I want. But we cannot do it on two different conditions because I'm not here to oppose you on your request. I am also the same thing, but we must do this under a united front. But this is not what is understood. You know, it is said from this, as it mentioned, you know, when you understand what is said here, subhanAllah, there's a speech that was mentioned, you know, that with the spread of Islam and the understanding that Muawiyah was in this position not for 1 year, but he held this position for more than 20 years. As the Khilafat, you know, as the governor of Syria. So the hold he had on Syria was that he had a very strong hold on the people, and that they were comfortable with him and they trusted him because he used to take care of all their needs. And that is no doubt a level of what relationship that he shared with them. But even under this condition, what is being asked of Muawiyah? It is being asked of him to at least come under the recognition of Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu as the leader of all of the Muslim Ummah. So this was his intention. This was why Ali radiallahu anhu came towards him and tried to make a settlement. Seeing that no settlement in this way could be decided, the only condition is to fight to attain the order of the Muslim Ummah. Hence the Battle of Siffin had to take place. So he had no way out of it. In the month of Dhul Hijjah, the 36th year after Hijra, the army of Ali radiallahu anhu started to gather at Siffin. And at last, in Muharram 37th AH after Hijra, he gave the orders to attack Muawiyah's army on the other side of Siffin. On the first day of Safar, the battle began, and the battalions after battalions, not all of them fighting at the same time. So they came in groups, one after the other, and they fight. And this continued for some time. So the martyrdom of a particular Sahaba, Ammar bin Yasar, radiallahu ta'ala, who proved that Ali radiallahu ta'ala to be on the right because of the following hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned in a hadith which is found in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim and Tirmidhi, that in this hadith it is mentioned by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who said that Ammar bin Yasir radiallahu ta'ala would be killed by a group of rebels. He will be killed by a group of rebels. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned this, and this came to pass. And when he was killed, it was recognized by Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu that this was indeed his side that was on haq and truth. So it became clear that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what he mentioned about on foretold hadith found in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, is very clear. So not a matter of just reasoning now, but it tells us clearly that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam foretold that this was going to happen. And hence, according to the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said that Ammar bin Yasar would be killed by a group of rebels. Since Ammar was fighting on the side of Ali radiallahu ta'ala and was killed by the army, Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Ali radiallahu ta'ala was on the right side. On the eighth day, the whole army of Ali clashed with the army of Muawiyah. That's after days of fighting. And on this condition, at the end of the day, Ali's side seemed to be gaining ground, and seeing this, Muawiyah called a truce of dialogue. He wants to know dialogue to be judged with the jurist from both sides, along with hundreds of members from both sides to give a verdict, but no verdict could have reached. After a very long duration, hundreds of men put together from both sides of the army now. So he said, let me stop, let me call the truce. But this wasn't the case, subhanAllah. What before this happened, Ali radiallahu ta'ala came up to Muawiyah. He says, let us not have these people fly. Let two of us fight instead. Let two of us fight instead. And whoever wins, they'll take Khilafat. Finish. But no one will ever challenge Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. No one will ever challenge Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because that Ali radiallahu ta'ala was the fiercest of all fighters on the land and of all that land that surrounded. No one would challenge him, because he took down all the fierce fighters from before. That everyone who feared to fight, he just went up to them and he had no fear. So Muawiyah said, no, this won't work this way. We'll have a truth. We'll work with a truth. And we'll find out who in the discussion of this will actually come to an end. But this, you know, condition continued the dialogue on both sides. And after the 13th of Safar, 37 AH, so Muharram comes about after Dhul Hijjah, Safar reached, a whole month gone, the next month starts, What is the condition now? They reach a stalemate. They saying two things happen, and this is where the Kharijites came about. They came with a new idea that both Ali and Muawiyah are wrong. Right? The decision that both sides were wrong, and they're not supposed to have each other fighting against each other. And that they will only go with Quran, and they will only go with the Sunnah, nothing else. And they will not accept Khilafat or the leadership of any of the people. So a new body started to grow and develop now. The Kharijites. Yeah. Yeah. The Khawarijites. Yeah. So they came out of this. Yeah. So they still also had the Shia already existed already from Abdullah ibn Sabah. And now the Khawarij, they also came out. And in this now, the army itself started to what? Dwindle. Because after such a long time, months, army waiting for what? Decision. Most of them left the field and they went away. But in the proximity of all of this, what really happened? And I'm giving you everything in a short format of it. 90,000 Muslims were killed. 90,000 Muslims were killed. And hundreds of thousands more were injured. The Battle of Siffin. One of the worst, some companions mentioned, is as though the skies were raining blood. You know, this is how sorrowful it was to see the nature of what they went down to. The Sha'ir and many poets, they mention that the speech of liars, you know, the speech of liars are sweet in the ears of the negligent. You understand what that means? So the speech of liars are sweet in the ears of the negligent, the ones who fall for different things in this world. And that is what he says, you know, Muslims are persuaded too easy on either directions rather than following what is the truth and what is haq. Because this is what we are guided by, the truth. What is the truth? Not who you are, but what is the truth. Regardless of what you be as a Muslim, the fact is, don't be persuaded by someone or some person, but be persuaded and guided by the truth. Not as it says here, that the speech of liars are sweet in the ears of the negligent, because they fall any side they hear the talk goes. Yeah. Yeah, till now, yeah. So, this condition, subhanAllah, may Allah subhanAllah, you know, give us an eye opening. You know, because till today, if you're watching Muslim Ummah today, if you ask over the last 10, 15 years in that same part of the world, you can see more than this number of Muslims being killed in that same part of the world. Hundreds of thousands of Muslims being killed over the last 15, 20 years. And not only just people in battlefield, children being killed, women being killed. And no one tells the difference of between who or what, because bombs and guns don't speak the language of what these people fought. They fought facing each other, but now just a press button and 10, 15,000, 1,000, 100, 10, 20, whole hospital, a building go on. That is how they have been killed today. All right, but what is the nature of the war? Why it is being fought? Still, it is still confusing in the eyes and the minds of people today. They are bewildered. What? Who killing who? Who is killing who? And what they're killing for? What is the purpose? If you look at Afghanistan, where is the war? Who is killing who in Afghanistan? Or any part of the world where Muslims and this war are taking place. Muslims are killing Muslims, and they are aided by other non-Muslims to kill other Muslims. But it is an eye-opener that the fitna and the part of disunity amongst the Ummah will continue on this path. And that's why it's very important as a believer, individually, as a believer, each and every one of us, each and every one of us must note that there must not be sides amongst us. when it comes to the Quran and the Sunnah and adopting this deen of Islam. Because Islam can only be one. It can't be no other thing. Islam can be something else but Islam. And anytime we choose a side other than this, then we are making some problems in our deen. So imagine this. For 90,000 Muslims to be killed on the Battle of Siffin, this, you know, it was a sad moment for Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who could not find with himself to even now return towards Medina and establish his camp or do anything at all. So where he established his camp in Kufa and so on, all of those things led him to go further and further away from this point. But it was not the end of Ali. It was only just the beginning of a situation that he further engulfed himself into. Because here, subhanAllah, the casualties being so much against Muslims to another Muslim. And they're not fighting with, as I say, fighting with a bomb, but they're fighting each other, facing each other, and to have 90,000 of them that died is not an easy thing. So just remember that piece of speech. The speech of liars are sweet in the ears of the negligent. That's how it works to spread disunity. So amongst them, as you said, the proof was that Ammar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he was killed, it was proof enough that Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his army was on the right path. And out of this, we see that the Khawarij, as I mentioned, now came into being because they did not accept the decisions of those type of things. And so the Khawarij reached 12 in number at the time they reached Kufa. They moved to the outskirts of Kufa. They appointed Sheikh bin Rabi' as their commander in chief and Abdullah bin Qawa as their imam to lead their salah. The policy was the only pledge loyalty to Allah alone and obey him alone. They rejected the khilafat and amirship. So this came out of what? The Battle of Siffin. They acknowledge that both Ali and Muawiyah are in error, and Muawiyah in error because he did not accept Ali, while Ali is in error because he agreed on arbitration. Understand the point? They're saying that Ali should not accept arbitration at this point in time. You're winning the battlefield. You're going to end today. It's going to be on your side. Why would you accept arbitration? Because Ali radiallahu ta'ala in the first place never wanted to what? Fight. He never wanted to fight. On the Battle of Siffin alone, he killed 500 men. No one killed that number. And every time he killed one, he turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in tawbah and repentance. Because it was a pain to him. But to face up to it, he had to what? Face up to it. Not one, 500. And this was their position, you know, thinking to themselves that, you know, he was wrong to allow arbitration. He should let the war finish. And finish off with Muawiyah and adopt total what? Leadership. But he was never of that opinion even in starting the war. He only wanted that they unite. And if this would have happened and there was a peaceful resolution coming out of it, the war would have still been what? Held as being successful because he stopped for the sake of unity. For the sake of unity amongst them that they will not continue fighting. So he was using every single advantage possible to not to fight. And even at this point in time, he still said, no, I will stop. He imagined he was on the verge of what? Victory. Not just like that, he was on the verge of victory. If he had turned now in his anger and said, well, I'll finish you off now. Imagine who he's finishing off. They will not even finish off a non-Muslim for their own what? Desire. For their own desire, because it is wrong, and these are what Muslims. And if his intention was for peace at all times, at this point in time, he was not going to what fight. So they take it to himself that he should have really finished him off, but he didn't do that because his intention was to enter this into peace. So their policy was that they only pledge loyalty to Allah alone and to obey Him alone, and they rejected the khilafat and amirship only because they acknowledge that both Ali and Muawiyah were in error. Muawiyah in error because he did not accept Ali, while Ali is in error because he agreed to arbitration. And Ali tried to squash the Khawarij. He sent Abdullah ibn Abbas to remove their misunderstandings. They argued with him. Ali radiallahu went himself, and they convinced them that the arbitration will only be according to Quran and Sunnah, which is the accepted, and joined him temporarily. So when he went to them, he told them, listen, what we are trying to do here is to bring a peaceful solution, and I'm going to do it according to Quran and Sunnah. But this didn't happen, of course, because when it came out as saying that both parties should give up the leadership of Khilafat or Amirship. So when the judges of Muawiyah and Ali sat for the period of 6 months period and came to the following solutions, Ali and Muawiyah should be withdraw their Khilafat. They should appoint a third person as a caliph. Amr bin al-As asked Abu Musa al-Ash'ari to make a public announcement of their decision, after which Amr bin al-As stood up and said, in my opinion, I believe Muawiyah is more fit. This showed that Ali Rajata was being pushed in a corner with a bias. You know, this is one judge, he telling you, say it. And so he finished it, but I think you should do this. You know, it's like, I give you the opportunity to make the announcement what we agree on, and then you come and say, but I think my opinion is that we should really do this. So he tried to what? Weigh in on the other side. And this in itself totally trod every possible opportunity of arbitration out. So the arbitration itself proved to be what, disastrous to Ali radiallahu anhu, and the people left disgusted because this was not based on Quran and Sunnah. He then delivered a lecture to the Jami Mosque in Kufa to the people and to prepare for an attack against Syria again. This did not go down well, and it did not come to plan because they all left. They couldn't handle going back to a war after what had happened. You know, to see Muslims facing each other in that condition, they couldn't go back to that type of thing again. So, however, as soon as the Khawarij knew that the result of the arbitration, they again separated and this time rose in an open revolt. A new group was formed in Islam that proved to be more dangerous than other groups existing before them, the Khawarij. Now, one, the Uthmani sect itself, that was with Muawiyah, because he had that connection with them, and they all from the Umayyad tribe went across there, and they stayed there, and he supported them. That is one group now we have what? Conflict with. Then the Shia, Ibn Ali, that set who started the what? The Shia sect with Abdullah ibn Sabah. That's our next group of what? Group of thugs and rebels by itself. And then now, the group itself of the majority of Muslims, the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the third group of Muslims themselves who now exist in. So you have three sets of people around the time of Ali radiallahu anhu, and then comes now a fourth, the Khawarij. And this was the most dangerous of all. They were more a political group and accepted Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhu leadership and refused Uthman and Ali and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. Because they said them was the one who started what? All the corruption, all the fighting, everything started from them. From the time of Uthman's death. That was the end of it. So they came about with this idea that the Islam fell because of that, and the Khawarij came on that line. Now we could think like that, people could think like that, but this is not it. The Khulafa'i Rashidin, subhanAllah, Allah guided their hearts, and Rasulullah predicted and proved to them that these are the what? The true leaders of Islam. And it came to pass that Ali radiallahu anhu, his leadership, were it not that he hold and stood up against all of the difficulties and the political situation that were around Medina, Islam would have totally what? Went into chaos. The whole leadership system would have fallen apart. So Ali radiallahu anhu, his position was very in a difficult position to deal with these splinter groups. And then came what? The Khawarij. They would kill Muslims who did not accept their beliefs. Today we have a group like that existing in the same land of Syria. In the same land of Syria, they're doing the same thing today. Right? Because of this group, Ali radiallahu anhu did return to Syria, as this group posed a great threat. Ali asked them for the murderers of innocent Muslims, but they refused to hand over those murderers. So in their group, they were existing and they were killing Muslims who did not believe in them. So when Ali radiallahu anhu went to them, what they say? You ain't got nobody. We ain't giving over nobody. So all of us are murderers, they said, and we want to murder all your followers. This was the condition that they faced with. So we would never stop for this. And they were, so the Khawarij, they were killing Muslims, Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the Sunni Muslims, who followed the Quran and the Sunnah, because they didn't follow the creed of the Khawarij. So once they pick up with you and they find you and you don't accept them, they finish with you. They kill you. The Khawarij, yeah. They were also Muslim who were under Quran and Sunnah. But when Ali came about, and Ali lost because of the fact that he accepted the arbitration between him and Muawiyah in the battlefield. And they stopped the battle. And that battle led to a whole long drawn out discussion and judging and so on. And at the end of the battle, at that discussion, it says that the two of them should be no caliph again. Choose somebody else. Well, them drop out from everything else and call themselves the Khawarij. We don't want to accept no Muawiyah, no Ali, no none of them anymore. We want to form our own thing now. And they started to believe in a different principle. And anyone who don't believe like them, they would kill them. So now Ali had to what? Face up with a new group of what? Contestants. So the stage reached when there was no other way than to fight again with them. So before declaring war against them, Ali radiallahu anhu declared that those who would be loyal to him and or those who left Nahran and did not fight would be given amnesty. You know what he's saying? Come back, don't believe in that practice, look, be safe. I will protect all you. I'll be protected again. This is how lenient he was. You know, it shows that it was a level of diplomacy. Because what they were doing were actually committing big crimes. They were killing Muslims. On his appeal, 3,000 Kharijites repented and again took Bayat at his hand, allegiance with him. The battle began. A fierce fight took place, and the Khawarij fought desperately but were defeated. Most of their leaders were slain. Ali radiallahu anhu searched the slain bodies for the particular man whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had prophesied and had given some signs which were really forecast of the Kharijites' trouble, that this person will be the leader and found amongst them. And he found them, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about the description of this person. So Ali radiallahu anhu found that body of that person, and with all the signs told by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and remarked, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very true in his prophecy. So in every aspect that Ali went through in his life, in every battle that he went into, everything the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had spoken about will come to pass, did come to pass. So you know what is the face up? A prophecy about a certain situation is like what we are told about what is going to happen to Islam in our time. Of all the immoralities that is taking place today, these are not things that Prophet never told us about. We are told about this. We are told about the fitna that the Muslims will fall into and that they'll never come out of it. And we are in this about fitna today. But we cannot understand what Prophet is saying. He says that is the time that is coming before us. When Ali himself see what is before him and the level of fitna that he was facing, and he was what? Asharul Mubashara, one of the companions who are going into paradise. Not just any companion, one of the companions who Allah has blessed, and Prophet ﷺ give that pronouncement that he would attain paradise. Subhanallah. So again, in an attempt to march to Syria to deal with the situation with Muawiyah, the forces of Ali wanted to arrest the Khawarij at that battle. But as they rested, many of them slept away. So after that battle with the Khawarij, Ali says, you know what, it's time for us to go one time and finish off with what? Finish off what happened in Syria. But by the time they take rest, when he look for the army, they all go. That was it. Under this conditional, he said, during this time, Muawiyah made an advance to Egypt and was successful in the meantime. The Khawarij, who were underground from their defeat, hated Ali, Muawiyah, and Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhu. They decided that these three must be assassinated. So they were underground. They come back out now. They decided to kill these three men. And the person to assassinate them were Abdurrahman, Muljam, Barq ibn Abdullah, and Amr ibn al-Barq, respectively. The early hours on the 17th of Ramadan, 40 AH, was the fixed date for the assassinations of the three of them. Who are the three? Ali, Muawiyah, and Amr ibn As. So, subhanallah, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu escaped with a scratch. He only escaped with a scratch. Amr ibn As did not turn out in the morning for Fajr as he was sick. And then he didn't get what? Assassinated. He was unhurt. He remained free from the what? That place and time from that actual thing. Ali radiallahu anhu was mortally wounded with the poisoned sword of Ibn Muljam. And he passed away in the evening of the 20th of Ramadan, 40 AH. Martyred. Killed. So what was his condition? The Khawarij get back at him. They planned for him. And they got him. So Ibn Muljam was caught by the people after he had struck Ali radiallahu anhu, and asked the Muslims to slay Ali radiallahu anhu, asked the Muslims to slay him if he died. At the same time of his death, Ali called his son and advised them to serve Islam and to be good, that is Hassan Hussein, his other son, with the Muslims. When somebody asked him, should the Muslims take pledge of loyalty at the hands of his elder son, Ali radiallahu anhu replied, I leave this decision to the Muslims. I am not appointing my son as what? The leader. You all make that decision. He also advised people not to kill any person other than the assassins to avenge him. Ali died at the age of 63 years. He ruled for 4 years and 9 months as the Khalifa. His exact location of burial was hidden from the people, as for the fear that the Kharijites would cause harm to his body. This is the condition of those people. And they exist till today. And Islam, we are told by the Prophet ﷺ, will be divided into 73 different sects. And it continues to be divided and divided and divided. It is a sign of the end of time. So what we see that took place at the time of Ali radiallahu ta'ala, at the time of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, was the sign of the things which is to come, the fitan that will not end. And many Muslims, you know, we still continue to preach that line of peace and submission. We should never stop from doing that, because Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu never stopped from doing that. He never stopped from doing that. He always strive for that level of unity in the Ummah. And as Muslims, should never feel defeated by this, because Shaitan, this is what Shaitan wants. He wants to disunite us, because when we are disunited, it's that time that we fall. As a result, as this we can see, Ali radiallahu anhu, the last point, tried to create unity again in the Ummah. So Ali radiallahu anhu said that he heard with his own two ears that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Talha and Zubair, they were in the battle of the Jamal, the camel. Remember Talha and Zubair, who joined with Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and they came to the battlefield in Basra. They fought with Aisha against who? Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But Ali radiallahu ta'ala said, I heard the Prophet said that Talha and Zubair will be neighbors in paradise. But they fought against who? Ali radiallahu ta'ala on the battlefield of Jamal. What was mentioned? Ali came up to Talha and Zubair and said to two of them, he says, you remember what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said? That you all will oppose me? You all will oppose me? When they heard this on that battlefield, what they did? They dropped their swords and walked. And while Talha was walking out, what was his condition? He was killed. And Zubair also left, and he was also killed at a different location. But Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu knew that every single thing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesied in his time came to pass before his eyes. It is not something easy. It was hard on Ali radiallahu ta'ala to see the condition of the ummah after knowing what? The condition of the ummah at the time of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are not just ordinary men. These are people who were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah. These are people when they had difficulties and their differences. How did they settle their differences at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? With swords? Never lift a sword against each other. The Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is what? Settle their scores in peace. So they knew only peace in resolution. But before jahalat, they were fighting among themselves. They would fight for everything. When Islam came in their life, they understood what was peace. They understood what was love. And then 36 years after, the 37th year after Hijrah, what did they see? That what they had attained, that goal that they had reached in life, that they will never raise a sword against each other, that their lives were loving to each other and kind to each other, as the Quran had mentioned how they live with each other. Subhanallah. You know that they enjoy a level of peace. Now confront each other with a sword. That is the nature of what? Destruction that the ummah faces today. And the more we try not to understand how important this is for us to come in our life, then implement the importance of unity in respect of submitting to the truth of Quran and Sunnah, rather than listening to lies or listening to different types of things. Listen to what is the truth that Allah and His Messenger had brought. Because that is the solution. Today, nobody wants a settled solution with Quran and Sunnah. Any meeting you go with, they are Muslims, there's always what? Fight, quarrel, somebody to agree. And they never use what? Quran and Sunnah now. They only call everybody what? Liar and thief and this and that and the other. Right? They never settle anything with what? Quran and Sunnah. This is the level the Ummah have reached today. The Muslims have reached today. And when this is the condition, the level of the Ummah today, and we want to talk peace and unity amongst ourselves, then the most important ingredient that is missing is what? What is missing? We want Islam, but we do not have Quran and Sunnah. Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, subhanallah, he was the closest thing to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was loved by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that I and him are like one. Meaning to say the relationship they shared as brothers. And they shared this in this life, and they will share it in the what? Life of the hereafter. This was his closeness. Ali radiallahu ta'ala, subhanallah, what was his life? Just like that of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he would never take more than he needed when it comes to that level of living and disconnecting himself from this world. Ali radiallahu ta'ala, one animal skin, a goat skin, he and Fatima radiallahu ta'ala, used to share that to sleep on. And used to share that same mat to cook food on, to prepare their food on, which would need the roti or the bread on. And then they'll take the same thing in the day and put the feed for the animal to eat on, the one camel that they had. Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, subhanallah, this was his condition. And he had access to all of the wealth. He, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would starve for days. He would see a stone and he would tie it to his stomach. Whilst he had access to wealth, he would give out all of his wealth, neglecting of his own self. This was Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his position as being a servant of Allah. He would spend his nights in ibadat and worship to Allah for the love of the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in his condition of knowledge, was a person who knew the entire Quran, who was the best of the persons of faqih and knowledge and deen at his time. No one could outsmart him in any type of knowledge in Quran and hadith. He would understand the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in every single aspect of the asbab of revelation, the reason of revelation. Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, subhanallah, he is mentioned to be at the forefront of all of the knowledge of deen. And this is Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he, subhanallah, for his own self, it is mentioned that he bought some dates and he carried them in his bag. Someone asked to carry this bag for him. What did he say? That the head of every family must carry their own burden. He took his life and family life to be very serious. Very serious. And he held that as a principle of the deen. People mention about him that he was an arrow of Allah that struck the target wherever it has to go. In other words, whatever he had to do for the sake of deen, he would do it for the sake of deen and nothing else. And he was that person who had the most amount of knowledge, as we mentioned. He was the closest and the noblest to Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was amongst the persons who established the level of what we call Sufism. He had a level of disconnection from this world. He never connected himself to this world. He had no attachment to the affairs of this world. That, subhanAllah, you know, that many people, when they mention about Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and what was his wisdom behind all of this, that he would go into the marketplaces, subhanAllah. And when he would go into the marketplaces, as the Khalifa and the leader of the people, he would go out there and read ayats of Quran and says, "Tilka darul akhirah taj'aluha lilladhina la yuridu 'uluwan fil ardi wala fasadan." That he would tell them that this tilka darul akhirah naj'al luha lilladhina la yuriduna 'uluwan fil ardi. That the life of the hereafter, the everlasting life, we have made it for those who do not desire from the affairs of this world and who will cause corruption on the face of this earth. Who will not attach themselves to this world. And he will spread this dawah to everyone in the marketplace so that they will not become connected to the affairs of this world. So they will not become connected to the affairs of this world. And this is how he lived his life, of trying to preach to people of living a simple life. Of living a simple life. But when Islam started to grow with wealth, it also affected the hearts of Muslims even at an early stage as that. And Ali was fighting against that. Ali was fighting against that to bring back the unity in the hearts of the people, because what was taking away their hearts was this world. The world started to take away their hearts. And they couldn't see where brotherhood lies again. And the only time you will see this is when it really goes back to the condition when Muslims have nothing again. Nothing in this world except themselves. Then they will come back again to each other. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the guidance and iman, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the Khulafai Rashideen and grant them the highest of status as the Rasulullah promised for them and their beautiful status in Jannah, inshallah. Sadaqallah, sadaqallah, Rasulullah Kareem. Ameen. اللهم انت السلام ومنك السلام تباركت يا ذا الجلال والإكرام اللهم صل على سيدنا وشفيعنا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين الحمد لله رب العالمين آمين
إني ألقى الإناس في صومي وصلاتي ودعائي للرحمن وجميع الطاعات جميع الطاعات إني ألقى الناس في صومي وصلاتي ودعائي للرحمن وجميع